Dr. Anand sir said, I am from Lucknow. Now Lucknow unfortunately doesn't have an LVBI, doesn't have an HB Desai. So where do the babies go? Well, there's still hope, I guess. So we set up an ROP program in Lucknow 3 years back, and I'll just take you through the journey of how our SAMROP experience was. Well, UP, as he just said, the largest state in terms of population in India, with 56 lakh live births. That's almost one-fifth of the entire live births in India. A huge infant mortality rate of 57 per 1,000 live births is a reflection of our not-so-nice public health infrastructure. And of course, the ROP burden in UP is probably the largest in India. And unfortunately, we didn't have a single program catering to the large number of premature babies born in UP, or even in Lucknow for that matter. So we started the SAMROP, as we called it, taking a cue from Dr. Anand's KidROP program, screening and management of retinopathy of prematurity. The core issues when we thought about setting up this program in Lucknow were, first of all, of course, is retcam procurement. That's the biggest challenge we had. The areas which we needed to cover. ROP in Lucknow, as recently as 4 years back when we started this program, was not a very popular thing. Very senior, prominent pediatricians would tell us, ROP to hota hi nahi hai. So that was as recent as 4 years. Manpower management to run the program. Then of course, patient follow-up and treatment. And as he rightly said, it's a crazy thing to do, so it has to be sustainable and probably scalable as well. So our RedCam was financed by a long-term bank loan, and we were just looking at generating enough to repay the EMIs, not to make money out of it. Our RedCam travels to private NICUs within Lucknow, with a radius of around probably around 30 kilometers. Unlike the NN model of where they have a fixed day for screening, our team goes on call. We don't have a fixed screening schedule as such. And referral from neighboring districts, the imaging is done at our base hospital. Although we do start in another three cities this month, but as of today, it's based only in Lucknow. Transporting the RedCam, we don't need a very huge tempo traveler or a huge vehicle to do that. Any vehicle with a roof which is high enough to transport the RedCam is fine. We use a newly launched MPV, which is around quite affordable for most single practitioners also. Awareness, when it comes to awareness, as previous speakers have said, we speak about creating awareness amongst pediatricians, neonatologists, gynecologists, all that is fine. But when it comes to parents, creating awareness amongst parents, we realize, is another important aspect of this. Parents spend a lot of time waiting in the OPDs of their gynecologists and pediatricians, and that is when we can catch their eye. So we put up posters in the offices of pediatricians and gynecologists in Lucknow. Quite a few of them got back to us wanting the babies to be screened. And there's an interesting story which Dr. Anand is a part of. This is a publication in the Economic Times recently. There was this jewelry businessman from Gorakhpur traveling to Lucknow. He had a set of premature babies just 1 month back, I think 2 weeks back. And he was just reading the Economic Times. There was an article by Dr. Anand Vinikar on the importance of ROP screening in Economic Times. He was just going through that article, and he realized, to his horror, that his neonatologist had not even mentioned the word ROP to him, and he had a set of premature babies. So he frantically went on to the internet. Dr. Anand is very, very much present on the internet everywhere. So he Googled him up. He contacted him about the ROP screening program, and he was given our contact in Lucknow. He came to us for screening. He wanted treatment in Bangalore. He went to Bangalore, got the babies treated, and now is doing well. So direct patient contact and probably presence in the media also works well. It's not only the pediatricians and gynecologists who would do all the hard work. When it comes to gynecologists, I'm sure many of us will have gynecologists as spouse. So pardon me for that, but in our experience, in our state, in my city, we didn't have a very positive response from the gynecologists. Most of them were not interested after the baby was out. We were just very lucky to have one or two senior gynecologists who supported our cause. Most others gave very strange responses. Here they are. Shocking, actually. One was like, if I tell my patients about the risk of blindness in premature babies, they would get IVF done somewhere else. The other one was like, if I tell my patients about the baby, they would say, we produce damaged babies. So the reasons were quite shocking, to say the least. So gynecologists, we have not been really successful in asking the gynecologist to convey to the mother, although she spends 9 months antenatally with the parent, but somehow they're not convinced enough for their own financial reasons, I guess. Pediatricians are more concerned. We, as Dr. Anand rightly suggested, joined the neonatology forum. We spoke about the disease in pediatric forums, and that helped us a lot. We put up the posters of the screening criteria in all the NICUs which we screen in Lucknow, and even those where we don't screen. The idea was to, the duty doctors in most NICUs, at least in my part of the country, are not pediatricians, to say. The pediatrician is a visiting guy. The duty doctor there is most likely an Ayurveda or a homeopath or probably a plain MBBS sitting there. So you don't expect him to look for risk factors. He would probably not know when to send a baby. So it's a great idea to have a poster put up in the NICU. He'll just blindly see whatever is required and probably send the baby for referral. It worked in our case also. And when we talk about manpower of having a ROP program, of course we need a retina specialist with special interest in ROP, somebody who's comfortable with indentation and examining babies, and of course a reasonable amount of comfort with and availability of a setup for lasers and intravitreal injections. And probably collaboration is the way forward. We don't expect to run the program on our own. The more than number of people we get in touch with, it's better for our program. Another important aspect of running an ROP program successfully is a pediatric ophthalmologist. As you see in this video, managing a child is not easy, not at all for a retina specialist. So that way, I'm thankful to have my wife as a pediatric ophthalmologist. And the refractive correction, squint management, amblyopia management, pediatric cataracts, and worst of all, managing the anxious mother. For that, you definitely need a pediatric ophthalmologist. As I said, I am lucky to have one, but you do need to have a pediatric ophthalmologist in your team. Then coming to the technical manpower, Dr. Anand has been nice enough to train our technician at his hospital in Bangalore. And as somebody was rightly saying, that probably an optometrist went on to become an ROP technician, our technician was an accountant before he joined the world of ROP. And now he can diagnose stage 3s and zone 3 disease as good as probably anybody else. So all one needs is passion, probably and nothing else. So you don't need, because in India, our paramedical staff is, we don't have too much of a talent pool in that sense. So we have to do with what is available. When it comes to patient follow-up and counseling, telephonic reminders, they make a difference. Although many times parents are very skeptical, that don't bother us and call us again. But our technician now is used to the feedback, and he'll keep pestering them till they don't come back to us. And another thing is that you'll just come to see, in our program, the follow-ups are free. So although they pay for the screening program, but it's a one-time payment. So they don't feel that you're calling them again and again because you want to make money out of them. The trust factor amongst parents, at least in my state, is very low. So we thought it's not a great idea to charge them every time. So that's why we have a free follow-up system. And a non-committal attitude is something which goes a long way, because even if you commit that the baby is absolutely fine, and God forbid he develops something the next visit or the next month, then he'll instantly catch you and say that aapne to kaha tha sab theek tha. So that is a difficult thing to get back to. So we always stay very, very non-committal, and that probably edges the parents to keep bringing the babies again. Of course, treatment is done by a green laser in our existing OT setup. For that, you don't need anything extra. As far as the As far as the second opinions go, it's always good to have networking in ROP. As I was telling you, that patient went to Bangalore for treatment, although he could have done it in Lucknow itself. Because he said, I want to go to somebody who does the maximum lasers in India. So he was an affording guy. Probably Dr. Anand would agree with me. He spent around 5 lakhs only in travel from Lucknow to Bangalore and Bangalore to Lucknow again. And that's how it is. So it's useful not to treat a very doubtful or unrewarding ROP surgery. That's what institutes are for. I would not suggest a new program to probably venture into complex ROP surgeries. It just gives you a bad name, nothing more. Small problems which we had, of course, practical problems which many of you might face. I was talking to one doctor from Delhi today, and she said, I already have a neck ache now since we started doing ROP, Neha in Delhi, Dr. Azad's team. She said, because examining a child can be extremely strenuous. Sitting and doing ROP lasers in the OT, on the OT table, is one modification which we tried. It works for most babies. And for somebody who's tall like me, I can somehow manage to make the baby on the OT, lie down on the OT table and do the laser. Because ergonomics is something which we need to take care of, especially in the long run when we're talking about doing ROP for many years together. Anyways, we as retina specialists, our neck has a hard time. And ROP lasers would last for around an hour or so, maybe more. So we have to take care of how we manage our ergonomics. Then when you venture about buying a new laser, we never thought of this. We were using our NIDEC laser for quite so many years. When we started doing ROP, within the first month of our program, our laser conked off. And to our surprise, we realized that the ambient temperature in NICUs is much higher than in our air-conditioned OPDs. It's like an oven there with a lot of warmers everywhere. And our lasers are not designed to work at that temperature. So within, and the laser is continuously used for almost as many as sometimes 5,000 shots. So our conventional lasers don't live up to that overuse. So whenever buying a laser for ROP, just make sure you do probably a trial in the NICU with the laser if you are sure that you want to use it for ROP. Otherwise, you might end up with a laser head which will not last for very long. When it comes to pediatric anesthesia backup, most single practices would probably have an operation theater set up with a regular pulse ox. All we need is a pediatric probe for a pulse ox. We don't need very fancy equipment to monitor the baby. And anyways, in any pediatric ophthalmic setup, you would have basic facilities for infant resuscitation and oxygen standby. So that much is enough. We don't really need very hi-fi stuff for that. And just in case if the anesthetist is not available, we have never done a laser without the anesthetist. We could probably go to the NICU itself and then do a laser. That's a safer thing to do. Now, coming to the crazy part of it, sustainability. Sustainability in our model, probably we have an upfront registration of babies. We do universal screening. Being the only RETCAM in our state as of now, we get referrals for RETCAM pediatric imaging. And of course, as Dr. Behera rightly said, 7% I think was your treatment incidence. So we really can't depend on treatment revenue for sustaining this model. The number of babies actually treated is very less. So expecting direct profits might not be a great idea. Just enough revenue to pay for a long-term loan and satisfying your urge to do ROP is probably the way forward. We charge a one-time registration. I'm putting the numbers here so to make you realize that it's actually possible. We charge a one-time registration amount of 2,500 rupees, and this is valid for 3 months. Now, this is irrespective of the number of visits of the baby. We might need to see a baby 10 times in a month, every third day, or maybe once in a month. It doesn't matter. The parents also feel very connected to us. They feel we are doing the best for their baby. We would see them every second day, and they don't pay anything. And in the process, they come to our hospital so many times that they are so well connected with our staff, with us, that the follow-up and the follow-up protocol is rarely missed. We have yet to see a baby who has not come to us for follow-up. Because I think in the end, it comes down to being about money. We also do universal screening. It's a nominal charge for universal screening, but it helps in adding up the revenues. There are a couple of gynecologists in Lucknow, and we screen all the babies for them. It's like vaccination in their centers. We get referrals for non-ROP imaging. That also helps in adding up to the sustainability. When it comes to scalability, we as private entrepreneurs need to know our limitations. We should have a practical approach towards travel logistics, manpower management, treatment limitations. As we were talking about government or NGO support, that is required but difficult to get. Coming to the travel logistics. Now, four-laning in Lucknow, for example, in UP, is under progress for many years. But as of today, the road conditions are something like this. Long travel time, poor roads. We couldn't even imagine taking the red cam on these roads. But as luck would have it, we have our elections in 2017. So now the government is all about making roads. So many highways have been completed this year. So now that's why we start in Kanpur and Gorakhpur now, because we have the roads ready now. So that's thanks to the elections next year. The government NICUs, this is an article mentioning our work in the local newspapers there. The government NICUs still don't do ROP screening, and they say we have optometrists to do it for them. Now I really wonder how an optometrist will look at the retina. So that's the CMO telling us that our optometrists will do it, you don't have to bother. Talking about NRHM, as Dr. Anand was saying, we do have a provision of getting 10,000 rupees for each treatment, but the system of NRHM is the funds come through the state government. So the center might be all hunky-dory about it, but the state government, when it comes to releasing the funds in my state, I don't think it's possible. And we went to the CMO office and we were told, Doc Saab, CBI inquiry is on. Do you want to be a part of it? So that's how things are in my part of the country. So we have stayed away from the government as of now. Although RBSK, in RBSK, ROP is there. So hopefully once the systems become more conducive to private partnerships, that is when we will look into it. So the eternal question remains, ROP for revenue? Definitely not. And what do we get? A mother's smile of relief. Realizing that had it not been for us, the precious child would probably become blind for life. Realizing that we are doing something which is life-changing, much beyond the regular cataract and retina which we are trained to do. So probably it makes it all so worth it at the end of the day. That's why we are here. And we'd like to thank Dr. Vinikar for inspiring us to start the program in Lucknow. Thanks.